the name of Jesus.
Amen.
There was once a young man who dreamed as the new years were starting and everybody makes their resolutions. This young man dreamed of becoming a great writer. And he told everybody, this new year, I'm going to start off. I want to be the best writer, the greatest writer of all time. Well, his family and friends asked for more specific instructions in this, and they asked him, what did he mean by being the great, best writer of all time? He said, I want to write stuff that the whole world will read. Stuff that people will react to on a truly emotional level. Stuff that will make them scream, cry, and howl in pain and in anger. So that man went to work for Microsoft, and he writes computer error messages. When I was in high school, James Abernathy was our computer teacher. For those of you around my age, y'all probably had him as well. James Abernathy was a computer teacher for years at Central High School, right here, right down the street for us. He had a poster in his room that said, if at first you don't succeed, take a break, and then take another whack at it. The problem, not the computer. I've always remembered and always loved that sign. You know, few things bring out our emotions more than computers and technology problems. Am I right on that, church? The older I get, oh my goodness, the worse it's becoming. Last year, we had gotten a new phone for Eli. Samantha, bless her heart, was setting it up for him. Everybody's still at the house. And she looks at us and she says, what are y'all going to do when I'm gone? Who's going to do all of your technical problems and your technician issues with computers and phones? Who's going to handle all that? And me being the father I am, I said, well, you got to leave for us to figure that out, first of all. So God answers prayers, church, is all I'm saying. Amen. You know, emotions are something that each and every one of us experience. We have high emotions, we have low emotions. We have emotions that can make us cry both out of anger, out of fear, out of sadness, and out of joy. We are filled with emotions. Few things bring out our emotions more than family and friends. Someone has rightfully said that we are millionaires in emotions. And they come in infinite combinations of type and intensity. And can I be real with y'all? I think, for the most part, we think of our emotions in a negative sense, don't we? We typically, when we talk about our emotions, we're usually, I'm sorry, I'm so emotional. I'm sorry I have anger issues. I'm sorry I'm crying. I'm sorry that I laughed during your funeral. I'm sorry for whatever it is. We have all these different array of emotions that come at the most inconvenient of times. And I think, we think of our emotions in a negative sense. We don't want to talk about emotions, especially if you're a man. You don't do that, man. You don't talk about them. We don't want to think about them. We don't have any desire to spend any time learning or dealing with emotions and the emotions that we've got. We've become accustomed to hearing the phrase emotional problems or emotional struggles. And so now we think of our emotions as a society, as mankind, as a bother and a liability. Have you ever felt as if you'd be better off if you didn't have all these emotions? Have you ever felt maybe you cried quite often? And hey, I'd be so much better off if I just didn't cry. I'd be so much better off if I didn't have my anger issues. I'd be so much better off if I wasn't so jealous. I'd be so much better off if I didn't have whatever emotion it is that seems to conquer us. I'm here to tell you that nothing could be further from the truth. Emotions are an indispensable part of us. But we got to learn how to embrace and employ them to be helpful rather than harmful. So this morning we begin a new series that I'm calling Oh, come on, church, you can't go wrong with some Aerosmith. My prayer is that this series will truly help us to discover all of these sweet emotions that God has given us, that God intends for us to use under His care. Human beings are complex. Our bodies, our souls, our spirits are actually intertwined and have direct impact on each other, both the physical and physically, personally, and communally. I truly feel it's vital that we learn how to embrace and employ all of the emotions that God has given us, and to see each and every single gift, every single emotion as a gift from God. One of my constant fears when preaching is that I'm going to be misunderstood, and it happens actually quite often. This is why you will always or quite often hear me pray before I preach for God to keep me silent and invisible, as big as I am. I never want people to hear Cameron, but God alone. With all of these messages on our emotions, I don't want anyone to think that everyone can learn to manage their emotions without Him. I don't want us to think that, oh, the preacher's going to teach me how I can handle whatever the emotion I'm struggling with. Hear me out, church. I don't want anyone thinking that I'm saying you do not need anything other than faith. Sometimes you need more. This is your preacher letting you know strongly. Sometimes you need professional counseling. Sometimes you need a medication assistance. I hope I'm not too far off when I say that most of our emotional challenges are of an everyday type, and they come from our reactions to life circumstances, reactions to the way we are treated by others, the way we treat others, because of the wrong thinking that we might have or others might have. But some of our emotional challenges might come from short-term or long-term trauma, chemical imbalances within our bodies, and they very well may need medical or medicinal professional help to cope. As followers of Jesus, we truly believe that God provides everything that is best and needed. Am I right in that, church? We believe it. We believe in God. We believe God will provide what is best and what is needed. I pray that quite often. That's a hard prayer to pray, because I don't know what's best and needed for myself, and I'm relying on God to do that. You know, even Jesus, before he died, was in the garden, and he prayed, not my will, but yours be done. That's a hard prayer, church. We don't know what his will is in all that we're having to face and deal with. So when it comes to this, I want you to know right now, I firmly believe God provides what is best and what is needed. And sometimes, when it comes to our emotions, what is best and what is needed might just be professionally trained counselors to listen to God and to help. It might be some form of medication to help calm our anxieties, our fears, and our struggles. You know, for years, I have prayed for God to take away type 1 diabetes I've had since I was a kid. But guess what? I still have to take my insulin every single day. If I don't, I get sick as a dog. I pray for healing. But I mean, God is providing what's best and what's needed in that medication that I have to take. I take drugs so I don't get high. Diabetic joke. Y'all missed it right there. See? I've got diabetes. If I don't take drugs, my blood sugar gets high, then I get one food test solid. Which I'll tell you about later. So, I firmly believe God provides what is best and what is needed. And sometimes, church, hear me out. Sometimes what is best and what is needed is professional help. Somebody who is trained to guide, to vent, to hear, to help. Sometimes what is best and what is needed is a break, rest. You know, God established this world and he created the Sabbath for everyone to take a day of rest. And we don't do that. Sometimes what is best and needed might be some form of medication, not to dumb us or numb us, but to help us and calm the storm that we're facing at that moment. So, don't be jumping to conclusions or judging each other in regard of any of these things. When it comes to our emotions, there are two opposing extremes that I want us to avoid. One extreme is to try and ignore our emotions, and we've done this for years. This seems to be the popular approach for anyone who claims Jesus Christ. The church for years has said, you know what, instead of dealing with these struggles, if you're struggling, you're just not praying strong enough. If you're struggling, you're just not doing what you need to do. You're not reading your Bible. Your faith isn't well enough. We need never forget that we have an enemy called the devil. The devil wants to break you in any way he can. The devil has no reason to attack someone who has already weakened their faith. He's already got it. The devil wants to grab someone who is struggling, someone he knows, who he feels he can pull away from God. The devil is a liar. But that's a sermon in a couple of weeks, so hold on to that. Our emotions are not something to deny, suppress, or ignore. When a person denies or suppresses their anger, their bitterness, their shame, their sorrow, fears, guilt, and more, those emotions don't disappear, do it? They just simmer and smolder beneath the surface, and they infect our insides. Those smoldering emotions do internal harm, and they end up boiling over, and if you're anything like me, I build up and I build up, and then I lash out against my wife and my kids. Not physically, but verbally, I snap, and it just happens. We've all been there, we've all struggled with this. So ignoring or denying our emotions is not helpful or healthy in any way. The opposite extreme is also when we allow our emotions to be in charge. We either ignore them or we let our emotions run us. If we allow our emotions to run the show, well, buckle up, buttercup, because you're in for a bumpy ride. If you run off of your emotions, you're going to make some strong, bad decisions. Emotional decisions typically don't work and make life harder. Us in the older generation, you might remember some Star Trek episodes. You had Mr. Spock, you had Captain Kirk, both totally different men. They make a good contrast of one who is completely emotionless and one who is prone and driven by his emotions. Or how about sense and sensibility? You have two sisters. You have Eleanor Dashwood, who's the oldest daughter, the heroine, who was composed and guarded with her emotions. And then you have Marianne Dashwood, the middle daughter, who is spontaneous and feels her emotions so excessively and is driven by them. I'm sure you can think of several great examples of extremes of two different types of people dealing in their emotions. We need solid foundation based on God's truths. And that's what this series hopes to bring. The first truth we need to discover is this. We're created in God's image, and God has all kinds of emotions. You might be surprised to know that throughout the history of the church, many a theologian or philosopher has denied that God has feelings, that God is just God. It's like they believe that thinking God has emotions would demean the concept of an unchanging God. This is reflected in a statement from the Westminster Confession of Faith. They said, there is but one only living and true God who is without body, parts, or passions. The scripture actually teaches something totally different. If you read your Bible, scripture shows a God who is full of passion and abounding with emotions. Genesis 6:6 says, and the Lord was sorry that he made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. God's anger against sin is expressed numerous times throughout the Bible. Jesus, the Son of God, while being fully divine, also expressed sorrow in John 11, anger in Mark 3, frustration in Luke 9, amazement in Luke 7, joy in Hebrews 12. If we deny our emotions, then we won't know what to do when God expresses his emotions. And God is full of all kinds of emotions. Our emotional makeup is one of the ways on which the image of God is seen in us. A second truth we need. We're created in God's image. And we're in need of physical, spiritual, and emotional unity. Physical, spiritual, and emotional unity. Everything working together with our bodies. We can relate to our physical environment. With our spirits, we can be in fellowship with God. And with our emotions, we can be affected by our relationship with God and with those around us. And sometimes we can't easily separate the physical, spiritual, and emotional aspects of our being. Our emotions can be affected by our relationship with God. And our relationship with others, for sure, can be affected by our emotions and by what we're going through at certain times. Am I alone in this struggle? Do your emotions sometimes get the best of you? Have you ever allowed your anger or your sadness to be poured off into others? Has someone ever irritated you and you take it out on those around you? What about physically? We don't even usually think about maybe that headache is coming because of the stress that we're under. Maybe that sickness that we're struggling with who knows what it is these days. It could be a plethora of things. There's just a jumble bag. I think they reach in and say, yep, today you've got strep, COVID, flu, the jump. That's a great, that is the best explanation for your sickness, isn't it? You just got the jump, or what is the doctor here locally? You got the crud. The what? Can you explain the crud? Is that physically, our emotions can get the best of us. Have your emotions ever caused any physical health issues for you? Me too. Someone wrote, the mind, body, and soul are very close neighbors, and one usually catches the ills of the other. Yeah. We typically talk about our body, soul, and spirit as if they're all separate items. Man, they all have to come together as one. And why? Because it's all inside of us. A third truth. God created us with these sweet emotions to be used His way. God could have created us without emotions. He could have made us as some intelligent, calculating, and sensitive machine. And if you meet certain folks, they come across as if they are that way. But that's not how God intended us. Imagine how dull life would be if no one showed any emotions. Imagine how life would be without the plethora of emotion we got. There'd be no sorrow, but there'd also be no joy. You'd never be able to enjoy the hearing your children or little babies laugh ever again. The deep, warm bond of a lover. The sympathy from a friend. That's not how God is. And that's not how God has made us to be. God has made us with emotions, not so that they could control us or destroy us, but so that we might be able to enjoy life and enjoy it to the fullest. And the final truth, God guides our emotions through our relationship with the Holy Spirit. The primary source of our emotional well-being cannot be tied to physical or relational things on earth, because those things are prone to change and fail us. Life and circumstances can be hard and painful. People can hurt us deeply. I don't know if you've ever heard that old phrase that hurt people, hurt people. Have you ever heard that before? Hurt people, hurt people. If they're mentally hurt or struggling, emotionally hurt or struggling, then they're going to hurt those around them. Hurt people, hurt people. But a healthy and consistent relationship with God can give us stability and guide us through any storm we're facing in life. So good at that, church. God has given us the ability to feel physical pain to protect us. This goes from physical pain also to emotional as well. The heat of the flame allows you to jerk your hand back so you don't burn the mess out of your hand. Shame, bitterness, anger are not to be ignored, but are designed to lead us to protection and health. But darn it, that old devil ain't going to make you feel guilty. He's going to make you, he's going to use guilt, rejection, fear, grief, depression, loneliness, all of those against us. So we got to be aware of his tactics. We got to stop blaming God when mess happens. That's the devil's goal, and the devil's plan is to make us blame God. Well, I don't know why God is doing this. I don't know why God is putting me through this. I don't know why God. Don't forget you got a devil wanting to break you. Don't blame God for what he's doing. That's exactly what he wants. Is to turn you against the Lord. God desires that each of us experience emotional and spiritual wholeness, and that we look to Him to provide the foundation of our emotional and spiritual stability through our relationship with Him. But like I said earlier, the emotional pain we struggle with might require some extra attention. What we're going through at times may require professional help or medicinal assistance. That doesn't mean that God is not your ultimate helper. God is just using those things as a means to help you out right now. God provides what's best in need, right, church? He provides counselors and medicine as well. For the next 3 months, I hope that we'll learn how to identify our feelings and embrace these sweet emotions. We got to stop ignoring our emotions, church. We need to learn how to identify them and own them, right? Our emotional wholeness will be and is grounded in our relationship with God. God has got to be our top priority. Let that be the only resolution you make to put God first in all that you are. Our relationship with God gives us the grace and forgiveness we need and long for. The freedom we find in the cross of Christ is broader than just our sin. In the book of Isaiah chapter 53, he says, "Surely our griefs himself bore, and our sorrows he carried." In Isaiah 61, Isaiah predicted that the Spirit of the Lord will come upon Christ and anoint him to bring good news to the afflicted, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberation to the captives and freedom to prisoners. In John 8, Jesus promised, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Through the cross, we are free from anything that imprisons us. Our relationship with God also brings us into a relationship with God's people, the church, the family of God. As we experience the love and acceptance of God, God also wants us to experience the love and acceptance of one another. The church is supposed to be a place of love, support, and relationships. As we just finished learning, we must protect this house. Our relationship with God will help develop a wholesome self-image. As we start this new year, we need to make sure we see our value in God. Not from anything you can purchase, not from anything you can wear, not from any new smell good that you can squirt on your body, not from what others see or say or think about you. God tells us that our faith in Jesus makes us priceless. The more we believe what God says about us, the more emotional health and stability we'll have. Our relationship with God leads us to true joy on the daily. I truly believe the following passages of God's Word will help truly learn and help us grab a hold of these sweet emotions. In Psalm 34, we read, "The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry for help. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears and rescues them from all their troubles. The Lord is near the brokenhearted. He saves those crushed in spirit." In Psalm 73, we see, "When I became embittered and my innermost being was wounded, I was stupid and didn't understand. I was an unthinking animal toward you. Yet I am always with you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel. And afterwards you will take me up in glory. Who do I have in heaven but you? And I desire nothing on earth but you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart, my portion forever. But as for me, God's presence is my good. I have made the Lord God my refuge, so I can tell all about you do." Here's Jesus' invitation down in Matthew 11. "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke and learn from it, because I am lowly and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Y'all, God hears, helps, and rescues us. Amen? How wonderful to know that the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and those crushed in spirit. How wonderful to know that our flesh and our heart may fail, but God is our strength and portion forever, and we can take refuge in Him and find His presence to be so, so good. But to be blessed by any of those things and in any way of those way, any of those ways, we have to accept the invitation of Jesus Christ to come to Him, to learn from Him, to be yoked to Him. If you've never become a follower of Jesus, then it starts by believing in Jesus Christ, by turning your life over to Him in repentance and baptism. Once we start to walk with Jesus, we will never give up anything that He gives. He will never give up on us, and we must never give up on Him. I love how last year at this time we started the year with a new series in learning how to lament, and how a third of the 150 Psalms are laments. People crying out to God in their anger, their frustration, their hurt, their sadness, their depression, their anxieties. And how that, one of my favorite lament psalms is actually Psalm 22. This is King David shouting out for help, physically, mentally, emotionally, all three of those emotions in Psalm 22. David is crying out pouring out his anxieties, his fears, his angers, his resentments, everything to God. And Psalm 22, being my favorite psalm, leads perfectly into the next one, where he begins by saying, "The Lord is my shepherd. I have what I need." Psalm 23 calms us as we walk through the valleys of shadows of death. Y'all, as we begin 2024, let's learn more about these emotions that we have and learn how to use these sweet, sweet emotions together. That child last Sunday that we celebrated, or last Monday that we celebrated being born, is here to guide us and help us each and every day. It's time we make him our top priority. Let me pray for us. God help us. Father, as we begin this new year tomorrow morning, help us every step of the way. All these emotions we've got, and God, you know we're going to struggle with some, you know, some we had a new problem with, and others we're really having a hard time. Father, you take our hard times and our hard moments, and you always calm those storms as we lay and build us. Whether we're a newborn, whether we're a young child, whether we're in middle school, high school, college, whether we got a job or don't have a job, and we're on our own, God, build us up strong than ever. Help us shut the devil up this year. Silence him from whispering in our ear those doubts, those fears, those anxieties. Help us learn to embrace these sweet emotions you've given us, and we can be totally yours. We make you our top priority. In the perfect name of Jesus, we ask this. Amen. Won't y'all stand and sing?